talk about developing a scale-based approach to jazz improvisation with diatonic chromaticism, which is a very fancy way of saying something very simple, which is that I like to play linear lines with half steps. So there's me, so I'm Mike Chamberlain. So this is going to be a linear focus on where to add half steps in your improvisation. I could have called this how to add half steps or just half steps. I'm all about half steps. It's the most important thing to me when improvising in this linear style. And this theory all comes from my research and working with the ideas of Barry Harris, the great Detroit piano player. And so a lot of these concepts started from his ideas and teaching, which you can find his stuff all over YouTube. He's got books that are published. And a lot of people follow Barry Harris for ideas on how to play in this style. And he's a piano player, so he's able to take some of these ideas and play them almost three-dimensionally, if you think about a piano chord, and move chromatically and using a lot of different things that I'm not going to talk about today. I wanted to gear this more towards horn players and playing in a linear fashion, which just basically means moving the line forward. So I also need to say as my disclaimer that these concepts are just a close look at a single approach to jazz improvisation. I'm leaving a lot out. I'm not talking about a lot of other ways to improvise. There's a ton of ways you can improvise and approach that. There's a lot of books, recordings, players, styles, genres, eras of jazz history that you can gain all kinds of knowledge from by listening to, studying, etc. So the big picture today, these are the big five that I'm going to cover today. So constructing bebop scales, an included and excluded, I'll explain what that is in a moment. The three limit resolution options, which are symmetrical, to the bar line, past the bar line, it's exactly how it sounds. And this is sort of my language that I'm kind of working on to get this stuff making sense on paper or saying it out loud rather than just looking at it on the page. And number three is identifying points of resolution and incorporating substitutions, which you may have heard that word before, especially in improvisation, playing something else over the harmony that's happening at the moment. And then applying these bebop concepts to moving harmony, which basically means 2-5-1 progressions, examples on standard tunes, and that's the big five that I want to talk about today. So why this matters to you? The goal of approaching improvisation with this method is to give you control and understanding, while also encouraging you to trust the unknown and let go. So once you learn all these ideas, again, you need to be thinking about something else once you understand these practice concepts. I consider them to be practice concepts. So the basic instruction. The first thing we have to understand before we can even talk about what a bebop scale is or how that works is playing a linear scale on the six most basic common harmonic key centers, which are listed up there. And you recognize those. I'm just abbreviating what I would consider to be a chord symbol. So major, dominant means mixolydian, Dorian minor would be a minor two chord, whole tone, and then melodic minor, when I say that, I mean minor one chord. So I don't have all of these written out today. Again, I have condensed some of this information down to make it a little easier and quicker to go through today. I had a sign up front. I have all this stuff written out. I have this exact handout, not the slides, but the music part in the handout. I'd be happy to email to you. And so you can take that later on. Now I'll grab your email and I can send that to you. I also had some staff paper if you wanted to take notes. That's what the staff paper was for, if you had any ideas that you wanted to write down. So let's talk about this. This is just major and dominant. So here you have root to the seventh, and when I say seventh, I mean seventh scale degree. And then the second line is root to the ninth. That means the ninth scale degree. And that's going to be your turning points. So you turn on either one of those notes, and that captures the basic, most basic linear sound of a chord. So for example, the first one. So F major 7, and I'm going to talk a lot about primary chord tones, non-primary chord tones. What I'm going to talk about here is the primary chord tones of F major would be F, A, C, and in this case we're going to call it E. Now in a minute I'm going to change this whole idea when I start talking about bebop scales. So this is not a bebop scale, this is just a scale. It's a good way to learn about the linear approach to the sound. And there's the same example down here on mixolydian. And I'm going to talk about how this changes when you start thinking about bebop scale. So I'm going to fly through some of this this so we can get into these bigger concepts with substitutions, etc. So the first thing we're going to do here is define what the bebop scale is. And this is, again, all kind of backstory leading up to these new ideas that I've come up with. And I'm just giving you the examples of major and dominant. So major, again, is Ionian, if you want to think modes. Dominant seventh is Mixolydian, if you want to think modes. And so here's the examples of those. So we're putting the half step, as I said right here, we're adding one half step between the fifth and sixth scale degrees in major, and adding a half step between the flat seventh and root in the dominant or Mixolydian. You can see that there. So now we've added the extra half step, and it's going to be on an offbeat. And what that does is preserve the chord tones on dominant. Again, that's the goal of doing this. And so these are just one octave descending options here. This is the most basic thing. So if you've never played these before, I should say, this would be the first place to start. Because we're talking about 12 major keys, 12 dominant keys. Just practicing this to get the sound of this in your ears would be a good place to start if you've never played anything else and you didn't want to go any further with any of the stuff I'm about to talk about. So, when I was going through this, my idea was, well, I want to think about this in terms of chord tones, because as a horn player, I can think chord tones pretty quickly. So I can think root, third, fifth, etc. fast. And I want to be able to recall that information fast and have that under my fingers. But what do I play as a scale? Because of course I can start a major scale on the third or the fifth. But what does that really mean? What happens if I write it out? And that's what this next idea is about. I don't want to read through all these. This is just some of my language that I'll be using throughout the rest of this. Included means we're adding the bebop half step. Excluded means we leave it out. The rest is pretty obvious about the resolution, either staying in one place, resolving to the bar line, or past it. And so I think it'll all make sense as I talk through it. So here we go. Major bebop scales, starting from any diatonic note. So again, I sat there and I said, well, what happens if I write all this out? And I write it out from every chord tone, every scale degree, what do I gain from that information? And what I learned is that if you call four notes, we have a seven-note scale, right? Major scale, seven notes. So if I call the root third, in this case, fifth and 13th, or sixth, depending on how you want to call it. Some people say sixth, some people say 13th. And I call those the primary chord tones, then the included bop scale for one octave works symmetrically, descending, ascending. So that means I can start on any one of those four notes, descend one octave, include the extra half step, and in major it's between fifth and sixth scale degrees, and you're going to resolve symmetrically within the scale itself. This is not really anything new necessarily, but I've just organized it for my, as a horn player, I've thought about this in terms of how do I think of practicing this with where I'm going to use the same pattern each time. Does that make sense? So I'm going to say primary chord tones. Here's four ways to do that on major. The reason we play the 13th is because there's a half step between the major seventh and the root, so we can't add an extra note there. So we have to add an extra note somewhere else. In this case, we want to resolve to the 13th. So that's a lot different. That's if you remember one thing about the major basic bebop instruction, it's that. Because we often think and practice arpeggios, we're going to practice up to the major seventh. And the example that I even showed before, where I said turn on the seventh and ninth, we're thinking about the seventh as a primary chord tone as far as the arpeggio is concerned. When we get into bebop scales, the major seventh is not a primary chord tone to make this pattern work out. Does anybody have any questions about that, what I just said? Right? In a minute, maybe. Okay. So, I was just going to play that one here. Let me play the one from the root just so you get tuned up to the key. So, if I go to the 13th. So this ends up working out differently. So I was working with this idea for a long time now, and my realization was that as far as the categorizing, cataloging of it, that we're going to call it resolution to the bar line, I'm now calling it this concept. So if we start on the non-primary chord tones, the other three notes of the seven-note scale, 7, 9, 11, we're going to resolve one bar later to a primary chord tone of the original major. So why is that important? And it's also different ascending and descending, which is why I have both of those examples there. That's important because if we were to play a line all the way down, and again, this is practice purposes. We're not going to improvise like this. This is just to get these sounds in your head and see what works, because you're going to use portions of this stuff later. So if I was to play that first one up an octave from the major seventh, I get to the 13th. Now I can have to play included to keep the pattern going from there. I'm going to start up an octave though, just so you can hear this whole thing descending. So I played excluded the first octave and then included the second octave. Okay. So again, this is the backstory. This is the stuff that I had been working with a long time. And a point of note for this particular presentation is that every rule that works for major also works for minor. I've done this presentation where I've talked a lot about melodic minor. We're just adding the flat third. We're changing one note. Everything works out the same. The root, flat third, fifth, and 13th of minor works out the same as major. So it's intentionally omitted, which is why you're not going to see much from melodic minor today. So now here's the basic run through. The same exact concept on dominance. And just to save time, I'm going to skip a little bit ahead now and just kind of move through this faster. So this is the same thing, except we're just dealing with the primary chord tones of dominant seventh or mixolydian, root, third, fifth, flat seventh. We include the half step between root and flat seventh, both descending and ascending, and it's included, there you'll see that, and symmetrical, which means it resolves down one octave and back up, and it is the same. So what's next? How am I going to include exclude the extra half step on dominant? So this is the same thing. We're talking about the 9th, 11th, 13th, and now we're going to exclude that half step. See that we're going from the root directly to the flat seventh there, and your arrival point is going to be a primary chord tone of the chord you're on. So this is, again, all the backstory. Here's another summary of the three concepts that I mentioned earlier, the three resolution options of major. Dominant seventh included descending symmetrical. That included bop will keep you within the same static harmony. That's the big takeaway. So if you were to play this stuff in a vacuum combined with surrounding chord tones and arpeggios, pentatonics, all these other things, you combine that with this, the included bebop half step will keep you where you are. If you exclude, generally speaking, it's going to move the line forward. This is not a perfect rule, but this is something I've been fooling with to come up with a reason why this is important and why you should know to include or exclude. And so if I play that first one, so we're staying where we are. It's a pretty short example. If I exclude that second example down, I'm just resolving to the bar line. Generally speaking, excluding the half step will help you resolve to the next chord, whatever it might be. In this case, it's 5-1. And the bottom example is, well, what happens if you continue past the bar line? That's the third step here, the third type of resolution. I'm incorporating some other ideas and surrounding chord tones there.
Yeah.
But that's kind of the basic idea. So this is kind of, I think, an important step to understand why. Because if you can stay within one harmony, constantly resolving symmetrically, you can double the rhythm. That's how you play 16th notes. So when you hear people playing faster lines or playing eighth notes at faster tempos, they're probably playing extra half steps added in there in logical places to keep you where you are. And then, generally speaking, excluding the half step to move up. And this is my thought on this. This is something I've been trying to figure out what people are playing. It's all about context. At the end of the day, it's what you hear and how you interpret someone playing it. This is why we transcribe as jazz musicians, because you need to get inside the mind of the person playing. And the more you transcribe, the more combinations you learn. You say, why did they play that combination? And why does that sound so good? And I think that this has something to do with it. They're very consciously including or excluding ideas. So here's the same thing, but in minor. I'm going to skip past this. Same exact thing. This is just a minor 5 going to, a dominant going to a minor 1.
That sounds like the wrong thing to skip.
What's that?
Sounds like the wrong thing to skip.
This one? Why is that?
I'd like to see what you're doing.
On this one? Sure. I just have a lot of, I have so much content, I'm gonna be skipping past a few things just to save time, because I'll be here for 2 hours talking about stuff before I get anywhere new. And, but if you wanted to hear a little bit of this minor one. So I'm kind of staying where I am. So that is just kind of staying, or excuse me, this is moving on then 5 to 1. The bottom example. So I've excluded that half step. That helps me resolve to the next harmony.
Sorry, Michael, just while we're on this, would that also work over B minor 7 flat 5? The minor 2 for this?
I'm getting to that.
Good.
Because there's, yes, because
okay.
I've struggled a lot of years trying to figure out what do you play on a minor 2 flat.
You and me both, Michael.
Right? And
yeah.
I've got a lot of options for this to explain how some of these ideas work into that.
Uh-huh.
And we get into substitutions and everything else, so that's coming. So thanks for bringing that up. So let's talk about this for a little. So I'm going to focus on dominant for a minute, and then I'm going to get to the minor two chords. But I want to focus on dominant because there's some cool ideas here. So dominant 7, flat 9, flat 13. Now the very first two lines, this is showing you if I was just to play only flat 9, what that would sound like. So we're talking about a dominant 7, included bop scale, only flat 9. It's sort of the notes of harmonic major, which is a weird-ish sound. A better option would be this dominant 7, flat only flat 13, melodic minor. I think it's a more common sound, and like that was just me writing down, what other options do I have? I can do it with flat 9 only, with flat 13 only, or with both. This flat 13 only option is going to come back in just a minute, because I found some cool stuff with that. But flat 9, flat 13, this is condensed now. Just to save time, I've eliminated some of this from this presentation. Instead of going out all the way through every scale degree, all 7, I just have a couple here. So here's, if I was to start on the root and the third of C and play that sound, flat 9, flat 13. So here would be included bop, root to the flat 7, flat 13, and then flat 9. That works out symmetrical. And you can practice that sound through all the chord tones, primary chord tones of C or of the dominant chord. Then if you were to exclude and play the non-primary chord tones following the same exact theory as before, and I only have 2 of them there instead of 3, it works out as well. And you're getting to a primary chord tone arrival, just like you did earlier in the dominant with no alterations on the dominant chord. So I'll move on from this to talk about how to resolve this sound now. So here's some examples of that sound moving from 5 to 1. And a friend of mine was telling me, maybe this sound is better resolving to the major one, because I think this is sort of closer to a diminished sound, I guess, or like this minor sound that wants to go to major one. But I think it works either way. But and these are, I guess these are all ascending options. Let's see if I have some descending ones. Descending ones tend to sound better. Not many people like to ascend, but which one should I play here? Maybe I'll play this one right here. So here is primary chord tones of C. So I'm just going to start on the root and play that ascending, but I'm going to exclude to resolve to 1. It's going to be kind of hard to hear this one. Yeah, I'm trying to set up the sound. So that would be, again, with the harmonic background, you'd be able to hear that a little bit better. But I don't have all that worked out to like kind of incorporate that to play with the background.
Can I just play a shell voicing under you?
If you want to,
yeah.
Sure, yeah, that'd be great.
So you want to be flat minor?
Yeah, that'd be fine. Some flat to just flat minor. Yeah. And so some of those sounds, thank you, are just very, very simple sounds, but they're going to help you resolve correctly. And every note you play has momentum, movement, and tension. Because you're keeping the chord tones on downbeats, which is one of the first things we talked about. Thank you. So here's some more ideas of that. These are just condensed examples. This is like continuing past the bar line, which is essentially what I just did. But it's hard to think maybe stopping at the bar line, but you can continue any idea past the bar line at any time. It's hard, like I said, to just stop your thought. But if you needed to, you can just practice getting your line resolved, boom, hit the next chord, resolve. These would be past the bar line, which is essentially what I just played. The 4 related down in 7th chords. This comes into play when we talk about substitutions later, and this is a great concept that Barry Harris talks a lot about how the diminished scale is constructed. And this, I don't want to spend a whole lot of time on this either, because I'll be talking about this for 15 minutes to get this explanation figured out. But the diminished scale is not, how do we normally think of it? What's the quickest way that people usually say?
You know, half whole, whole half.
Half whole, whole half, sure. And Barry Harris says that you take your diminished seventh chord, and then you take those four notes, and then you take the roots of the four related dominant chords to that diminished seventh chord, and that creates the diminished seventh scale. So in this case, you'd be taking the roots of C, E flat, F sharp, A, and combining it with a D flat diminished chord. I know that's probably like it's a lot to unpack in just one sentence to understand it quickly, but if you were to play a D flat diminished seventh, and I'll just play that on the set. If I drop the D flat a half step, I would then be playing, and kept the other three notes the same, I'd then be playing C7. And if you do that the same with the other notes, you get the other related dominant chords. So I'll drop the E a half step. And then it works for F sharp and A as well. So you take all those notes combined together, that's the diminished scale. And it's important to know, because what do you think of when you see C7 and then F sharp? What's the first thing you think?
Really?
But just the roots, just the relationship.
Tritone.
Tritone. This is where the tritone substitution is coming from. Because it's all related to the dominance of whatever the root is of the dominant chord around the time. Okay. Let's move on from this. So here's dominant 7th flat 9. This is just purely diminished. So diminished scale, since it's an 8-note scale, we basically exclude. So there's no additional half steps added on that, and that works out exactly one octave. So that pretty much takes care of itself. That's the diminished scale as you know it. There's nothing really different about that. And so there's from the root, and then now we're going to be up a half step from the root. That works out symmetrical. Here is down to 7 flat 9 diminished, 5 to 1. Again, let's go into a minor. Do you want to play another short round? It's the same key here. I'll play that past the bar line, the first one there, and see what this sounds like. Condensed it down, these are excluded. This is where I don't want to go too much into explaining every one of these options, because we already know that this is an option. So it's the same concept. We're taking notes of D melodic minor, and we're playing that scale, that sound, over the G7 sharp 11 in this case. And so, just for the sake of time, because I'm already running short on time.
Just a quick question.
Yes.
It says G7 sharp 11 to G minor 7?
Yes. So, this would be, I'm considering this to be a dominant 2 chord.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, we're kind of in a different key now.
Okay, I got you. Okay.
So this would be like towards the end of Cherokee. This would be like sort of the second bar of A-train, but we don't think of this sound second bar of A-train. We think of like a whole tone sound like that. I mean, I'm sorry, third bar of A-train, second chord. But yes, we'd be, generally speaking, the dominant 2 chord would have a sharp 11 resolving to
this.
Sometimes when you look at lead sheets, it might not have that sharp 11. That's something to consider too, that certain tunes that would have that sound. It's really supposed to have the sharp 11 sound. So the optional one would be to do D melodic minor. So there's a bunch of options on that. This is the past the bar line options on that. And again, for the people who came in a little bit later, I have this all written down in a handout. I'd be happy to email it to you, all the music notes. So just send me your,
so
give me your email.
So what's your basic premise?
Basic idea is to put chord tones on downbeats using half steps. The most simple way I can explain it. And it's following kind of what Barry Harris's method is of using bebop scales to do that. And so this is something that I've spent time writing all these options down to figure out what else I can get out of the same information. And I can't believe how much there is. Every time I think I've got everything written down that I could possibly think of, I'm like, well, what about this? What if I try this? What about this option? and then write it out for every option, every scale degree from the substituted chord for key center, and I come up with more options. Here's the one I want you to remember on this. So we're still in the dominant two chord. I'm saying play, think up a half step, or excuse me, up a major second from the root, and play that included bop flat 13 scale. And this comes back a few times. I've figured out that this substituted sound works pretty well for this. Again, it's hard to hear without the quarter of it. So this would be, yeah, like F7, yep. Sell, but the premise is there that you have this included bebop scale with just the flat 13 that works, that sound works. And you can take that through the root, third, fifth, seventh of A, and it works. These are descending options to the bar line, descending and ascending, because again, it's different when you're excluding the house. So, and if you flip over here, literally, this is the condensed examples, meaning like I'm going just a few ideas as you went past the bar. Maybe one more time, I'll play one of these. Let's play the top one. Like if you think about it, but you'll get to the arrival point a little early. So maybe you need to start these on beat two or something like that to get the excluded to work out. If you see an actual dominant seven sharp five, 9 times out of 10, it's going to one. There's a couple tunes where this chord will happen quick, and you're going to go right to one. And so I've had to add in, like you can include the half step, which I did here, but if you just go down the regular whole tone scale, one octave later puts you here, but it actually helps you set up the resolution here. So this is a sound where I'm still trying to work out like how does this resolution affect, you know, whether you're including or excluding. This is sort of another gray area where it works, it just depends on how you think about it. The idea is to resolve to the next sound, and this is continuing down the same scale, so it works. It's a little bit different from the last couple of ideas that I talked about. But you'd be thinking of the same sound up a major second from the root of G and playing the chord tones of that, but just the sharp five. So we're doing on time. I got a lot of stuff to talk about yet, so I want to get into just a few transcription examples at the end here. I'm going to skip through that. Altered chords. All right, so I missed this first part here. So think down a major third, down a seventh, flat 13. This is the same sound, down a seventh, flat 13 only. If you think down a major third from the root of where you're on, it's an interesting sound. The long explanation is that you find the tritone of that, which in this case would be D flat, and then you go up a step, and that's how you get to that particular chord. It sounds a little crazy, but again, it works, and this is a unique sound. This is something that I've been fooling with. And altered, we're really thinking like in a minor key. This would definitely be resolved in a minor. If I play this, it's just going to sound more like, it's going to sound exactly like an E flat chord. So this would be like F7 altered. That's staying where you are. If you're going to resolve, let me just queue up the next page. I think I have a resolution here. So this would be like, yeah, your F7 going to be flat minor. So I'll play that first one there. Essentially, right, it works. But I think that the explanation is that it's the tritone. It has something to do with the tritone. The tritone and the relationship of this sound to the tritone. But right, it's coming from the same melodic minor source. The idea is like the conception of it. Like, what am I thinking of? I'm going to think of the chord tones of E flat 7 to get me my starting point, or possibly a resolution point if you're playing into that. And then continue that thought process from there. It gets you out of thinking like, well, what do I do on altered chord? Because I know that this is the seventh scale degree of melodic minor, but I can't just play A flat melodic minor. It doesn't work. Like, you can't figure out a way to make it work even if you're including the half step from A melodic minor. I know I'm saying a lot of stuff fast, so I'm sorry if I've lost anybody on this part. This is about as deep as I get into dominance. Right, and you can think this, you know, the A flat, it's maybe not the best sound because it's hard to get to play out right, but you can include it and it works. So there, that would be A flat, melodic minor over the G altered chord. So here we have altered dominant resolving to one minor, because this, by the way, was just out of context altered chords, just practicing that sound and a couple resolutions. This would be like, if you're going to resolve it now, what would that sound like? And here are some more ideas with that. And I've got every different type up here. You know, I've got melodic minor, I've got this down, excuse me, this was a different one. This would be the down, a major third, flat 13. Here would be playing straight up tritone, and some other ideas on there. This is, I know this is pretty dense, and that's why you really need to look at the handout later and kind of go through this after this presentation of, you know, when you have a minute to sit and think about it, play through some of the ideas. Here we get to half step, oh, here we go, half diminished chords. This is your section.
Good.
Yeah.
Okay.
So obviously we can call it just straight up Locrian, think major. So if it was a C half diminished, we could play D flat major. And so I'm thinking of the chord tones of D flat major, which is really, it doesn't really work. It sort of does. The triad works, root, third, fifth. There's that weird ninth thing. In the seventh and the ninth, it starts to get a little bit weird. But I've written all seven out here, so you can see that. So I'm calling the primary chord tones only the triad of the D flat, because it's technically a substitution at that point. And then you have the non-primary chord tones, 7, 9, 11, 13. But that's all coming from major scale harmony. And this would be, and also it's weird because those are excluded first, which is backwards from the other theory earlier. So a lot of these rules, I don't even know if they're rules. They're just things that kind of exist, I guess you can call them. Because it's hard to remember every one of these rules. I don't think like this necessarily when I'm improvising. I don't think, well, I'm going to go up and have stuff and exclude. I've just practiced these ideas. I'm trying to incorporate things and find out what works the best. Because only, honestly, a few of these ideas really sound like the stuff. So that would be included. Okay, so here we go. This is the one to remember on half diminished. Down a major third. From the root. And this is playing just straight up included bop. So no flat 13. Although we could probably make that sound work. But
are you differentiating between natural 2 and flat 2 in this?
In this one, I'm thinking, well, of what chord though?
For the half diminished chord.
So, right. In this one, I guess it's technically it's flat. This would be flat 2 because I have a D flat, because I'm saying play the notes of A flat 7. So I guess it's still technically we're in D flat major then, still. But I like this sound a lot. This sound makes sense to me as far as like getting that sound to kind of work out, because this helps you get to different resolution points too. Because this again still is kind of staying within the one harmony. We haven't even resolved this yet. There's the excluded options. There's more options yet. So I mean, this stuff, like as you can see, it's too much to even read every line. This is a lot of information. It's all in this head. There's the excluded options. And there's more options yet. So I mean, this stuff, like as you can see, it's too much to even read every line. This is a lot of information to kind of unpack on that. And you can also, I like that option the best, just I think. Because it's really hard sell to get that natural too. Which would be like the D natural on C half diminished. It's a hard sell. And then you can always think a two chord of harmonic minor. And those are some interesting sounds as well. So here's the complete minor 2-5 resolution, which maybe one of these would be neat to play through. Let's do the D harmonic minor. Let's do this. So we're in C. Half diminished. Oh man, there's like too much to talk about here. Let's just do the very first one up there. Can you play that one too?
2-5 and 8 flat minor.
Yeah, 2-5 and 8 flat. these are all written out in that handout for you to look at. And then this is now kind of the back third, which I was hoping to get to this a little bit sooner, but this is moving from just things that you kind of need to know. This is like just basic stuff. You gotta know how to move from 1 to 5, back to 1. You gotta know how to move from 1 to 4, back to 1. These are some lines that kind of do that. You also need to know how to go from, sorry, you wanna go back on that? You have to know how to go from dominant 1 to dominant 4, which is bars 4 and 5 and blues, right? So you gotta know that sound. So like this sound, for example, like everybody knows this sound. Maybe some of these reference points will help you along the way. So here's a complete major 2-5, but let's start with the 2-5 part of it first. This was an interesting thought, was just to play 1/2, because I haven't talked at all about Dorian, because Dorian, to me, is not really what you think it is. Dorian is really part of 5, or what if you called it 1? So what if we just played notes, literally notes of 1? This would be C major included bebop, because we have 6th going to 5th, descending, and then resolving into the 5 chord. Now, the first thing you're going to say, well, is this doesn't make sense, because why would I play the 4th on the 4th scale of the 11th on a G7 chord? But in a minute, when I talk about tritone substitutions, you're going to be playing, like, let me get to that first, so I don't confuse you even more. Well, we can make these sounds work, like playing different notes than what you maybe would think to resolve to. So here's a complete 2-5-1 in major with minimal additions using some of those sounds. Just to play that first one real quick. So you might look at a transcription, let's say you're looking at the Omni book and you see Charlie Parker doing these notes and you're like, well, okay, I got it. That's the flat 5 of G. And he's playing the flat 13 of G. And there's the 7th. I got it. I understand what notes he's playing. But that's you thinking about it in relation to G. Charlie Parker might not have been thinking G. He might have been thinking the tritone. And if you start seeing notes that make sense more as tritone, maybe he was playing the tritone. And there's no way to know what some people were thinking. But this is just trying to gain some context out of maybe what you see or what you hear. So we are fast approaching the end of time here. The end of time, that sounds terrible. So tritone sub over tire 2-5, major and minor keys. These were what I was getting into, actual tunes here. And the keys, I believe some of these keys were concert, but this would be playing the entire tritone over 2-5. This is playing the tritone over entire 2-5 major key. These are some examples on tunes. I have to breeze past this now. This was a couple more. This was the other two related dominant chords. We talked about the tritone. We didn't talk about the other two. That's what this was. And complete minor 2-5-1. This is some more tritone stuff. I'm getting the transcriptions, but I want to play these for you so you can see some of this stuff in action. There's some more options with that, past the bar line. Again, I told you I had too much stuff.
So are you saying this is Barry Harris's approach, or this is your own device?
This is me taking what I've learned from Barry Harris and expanded it. Because he might say
Barry Harris?
I didn't study with him, but I've studied his music
stuff.
Yeah,
okay.
He's someone that I really want to spend some time with if I can. Because he's still up there in New York playing and teaching. This was just kind of an ongoing thing that just kept building and building and building. So we're going to listen to this very short Keith Jarrett tritone sub here. This is in concert key. Here like I'm trying to identify these sounds. I was trying to find a real clear example of that. I think that was one. Here's Sonny Stitt playing Indiana. Some of the note choice, you start to look at it, the line of the sequence overrides the significance of the individual note choice. So this is not like you have to do this included, excluded. You do what you sound right to you. So there was something sitting. I got one more quick one. This is Michael Brecker playing on like a blues. Shape, like for example this shape here that he's got this surrounding the third and then resolving to one, he's playing that same shape here but resolving to a different chord tone. Like, so his point of resolution in his mind is like that point, and in this particular tune he's either hitting B flat, B natural, depending on what the chord change is. And up here he had that same shape was right here where it's that same exact shape, but you can see here he started on beat three, resolves to the third of G here, and down here this shape resolves, starts on beat one, resolves to so some of the stuff that's hidden can be over the bar line different. And so it's out there. When you listen to the music, you might start to hear some of these sounds. Some of them are a little more covered because it might only be a portion. So I gotta stop.
You can leave your email address on the paper at the music stand.
So I go to the store.
Yeah,
so they gave it to me and I tried my final.
said come back, because the registration model is the one you like, you could have that exchange.
Yeah.
And then once I get back up to Van Doren, I realize I'm trying not the large game. But then turn out like that even better. So they would have no stake to work out in my favor.
I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
Yeah, they're.